Okay, let's talk about prokaryotic cell structure. We're going to start with the cell membrane. So we'll just put a one on here for the first structure we'll talk about. Cell membrane. Sometimes this is called the plasma membrane. The cell membrane of prokaryotes, like primarily bacteria, are phospholipids. So this is just like any cell membrane that you would have learned about in a general biology class. You always got to have lots of lipids with phosphates on them. And then there are going to be proteins, and these often help make up the channels. So basically ways that things can go in and out of the cell. And then we'll use pink to say what the function is of a structure. So this is the cell membrane. We'll highlight it in yellow. So that's structure number one. And then with pink, we'll talk about what it does. So basically, the cell membrane is really important for allowing nutrients to enter. So examples of this, what is a nutrient, right? Well, sugars, amino acids, fatty acids, all of the same nutrients that humans would think of as nutritious. But one thing that's different is when you think about a human, we might eat a piece of steak and it has proteins and fats in it. And then when it gets into our digestive system, we have enzymes from our pancreas that are able to break those down into fatty acids and amino acids. Well, the way bacteria do this is they secrete extracellular enzymes. So the enzymes act outside of the cell. Break down, let's say there's the bacteria is growing on a piece of steak, it will break down the lipids into their fatty acid components. Then they can bring the fatty acids through the protein channels into the cell. So you could say that the cell membrane regulates not only entry, but also exit of anything that's any kind of enzymes that are going to go out of the cell. Okay, so now I want you to get a green pen. And whenever we use green on this page, the purpose will be to talk about ways that we try to control bacteria. So here's an interesting one. Sometimes antibiotics are able to enter through a channel that was meant for a nutrient, and then the antibiotic can get into the cell and stop the bacterial cell from doing whatever it wants to do. So it's kind of like a Trojan horse. It sneaks its way in. And remember, humans didn't really invent any antibiotics. Antibiotics are naturally made mostly by yeast and certain kinds of bacteria like Streptomyces, or is that a fungus? Anyway, so other kinds of organisms will make the antibiotics. And then in laboratories, humans have refined those and made further generations of them. But sometimes antibiotics can come in through and then that's how an antibiotic could do its work. Then another way that we can work against bacteria at the level of the cell membrane is with things like alcohol and ammonia. They disrupt cell membranes. So we'll use green again. Oops, I should have done that the other way. Anyway, they disrupt. And so that's why you're always going to be hard-pressed to find something that's a better disinfectant than alcohol. And ammonia is also a very good cleaner. And in fact, in hospitals, I think they use lots of, I think they're called quaternary ammonias, and those are common cleaning agents in hospital-like settings because they disrupt cell membranes. Okay, so the second structure we'll put on here is a cell wall. So let's go all the way to the bottom of our picture and put number 2, cell wall. As we've already learned this quarter, bacteria always have a cell wall, or almost always, there are a few exceptions. We're going to use a blue highlighter, and what I want you to do is just trace all the way around the bacterial cell like this. And in case you're wondering what that looks like up here, it doesn't look very good, actually. I just kept my blue going. So number 2 is the cell wall. Now the cell wall is made of different stuff than the cell membrane. Think of the cell membrane as squishy and fatty, and the cell wall as more hard, like a tree trunk. Because sure enough, it is a little bit more like a plant cell wall. What makes it harder is that it has more proteins and has more carbohydrates in it. So, like cellulose is what makes up plant cell walls, and there's something called this glycan. Oops, sorry, this is really blurring up on us. Peptidoglycan is what makes bacterial cell walls stiff. And then if we're talking about gram-negative bacteria, they even have then outside of this protein and sugary cell wall, they have more lipid too. Well, I'll put negative. And that's on a different page of the notes where we'll talk all about the cell walls. They sort of deserve their own page because bacteria have such awesome cell walls and they can be a little complicated. So I'm going to list for you in a very simplistic way one really important reason that bacteria have cell walls. And that's to prevent rupture so that they don't explode. Because they live in a hypotonic solution. What that means is that if they're very concentrated on the inside with all the goodies that they're going around and storing, so the water in their environment wants to go in. But if the water in the environment were to go in enough to equilibrate the concentration, then this cell would become so swollen that it would rupture. So the cell wall prevents too much water from going in and causing rupture. So if you can disrupt the cell wall, you can stop the cell from successfully growing and doing what it needs to do. And sure enough, that's how a lot of famous antibiotics work. The penicillin mold made it the most famous and first discovered antibiotic called penicillin. So what we'll say here is if you can block the cell wall formation, that's going to be a pretty effective antibiotic. So examples would be bacteria that end in cillin, like penicillin. So I'll just put the cillins. Vancomycin, that's what's used to treat MRSA commonly. That is a cell wall inhibitor. And an antibiotic known as cephalosporins. And there are others too, but that's kind of a good starting list for you. Okay, so that was structure number two, the cell wall. Ready for structure number three. Let's see, what will I do next? Oh, the glycocalyx. So number three, I'm going to write about it right here. So this kind of looks like more cell wall once you see me draw it. I'm going to use a yellow highlighter, and just like we put the blue outline, now do a yellow outline all the way around. Not all bacteria have a glycocalyx. I would say most of them do, though, especially the ones that are good at making us sick and giving us cavities, because the glycocalyx often helps them stick to different parts of our body. So you can see in the name, it literally just means sugar, and calyx means coat, so sugar coat. And so it's sticky and kind of slimy even. If it is really strongly adhered to the cell wall, then it's called a capsule. And the purpose of that capsule, so that's one kind of glycocalyx. So we'll get our pink pen again for why bacteria have a glycocalyx, is to help bacteria adhere and it's very important to help them avoid phagocytosis. So it makes it harder for our white blood cells to engulf a bacteria that has a capsule. And sometimes, so it may aid, it may aid in triggering endocytosis. What I mean by that is, it might actually make our cells voluntarily take it in. So it's, again, it's like a Trojan horse. So it can help them stick to us, and it can help them basically avoid our immune system and then maybe even go inside of our own cells. So capsules are really common in bacteria that are able to make us sick. And then if the glycocalyx is kind of floppy and doesn't stick really tightly to the cell wall, it's called a slime layer. And you know how sugar gets all sticky on your hands? That's what can happen with the slime layer, and it helps bacteria stick to our cells, and in our mouths it helps them stick to our teeth. And the way they do this is that they use glucose, and so like if you eat sugar and have sugar in your mouth, then the bacteria can use the glucose to make this slime layer. And that's what plaque is a bunch of bacteria with their slime layer adhering to your teeth. So Streptococcus mutans is famous for this, and in fact it even gets its name because it mutates the teeth or changes the teeth. It causes cavities. And we're finding that this is the ability to make a slime layer is also important in bacteria that can grow in our circulatory system, either in our blood vessels or on our valve walls. So all I'll put for now is it's important part of the pathogenesis of bacteria involved with cardiovascular disease. So mouth health and heart health are very closely related. Okay, so we'll come back for part 2.